What's that mean? Yeah? Oh, there we are. That's better. It is my honour and privilege to be introducing you to Elizabeth here, who most of you possibly know in some form or another. And she has a wonderful insight here. I don't need to read it to you. I don't have to. I will let the lovely Elizabeth continue.
Thank you. Yay. Okay, so we're good with a mic? Is that working? Keep talking. Is that? I hear an echo now.
Yes.
So, all right. Hang on.
Sorry, it's where they put them, the lapel. Would you mind taking your jacket off?
Yep, I can.
That okay. Should be much better.
All right, is that better?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So my name is ElizabethK.Joseph. I'm here to talk to you a bit about listening to the needs of your open source community. So this talk is a little interesting for me. I've been working on organizing open source communities from Linux users groups to online communities since about 2002. I spent six years working on the Ubuntu Community Council, and then I spent 4 years paid by Hewlett-Packard Enterprise to work on the OpenStack infrastructure team. In both these roles, I learned a whole bunch of stuff about listening to your community. In the Community Council, it was sort of our job to make sure that we were listening to people in the Ubuntu community so they had the resources they needed and can get their job done. In the OpenStack infrastructure team, I worked as a sysadmin, and we pretty much ran all the services that the developers in the OpenStack project interact with. So by design, we always had to listen to what they were saying to us because we were running their tooling. And you know, when I put this talk together about 6 months ago, I was like, this is all really obvious stuff. But I just joined a new company about a week and a half ago, Mesosphere, and they open sourced a project called DCOS several months ago, and they're going through all the steps of needing to open up their community and build their community, and suddenly I'm finding this list of 8 things that I'm going to show you actually very useful to show them and say, these are all the things we need to do in order to have a transparent community that talks to each other. So that's my new job. It's pretty exciting. So, as I said, I've got 8 tips that I'm going to run through about listening to your community members. And sort of the starting point is that maybe you have a project that doesn't have very many contributors yet. You sort of want to have more contributors, but you're not really sure where to start, or that your project isn't growing and you're not sure why. So the first one is something I thought was very simple, but it turns out there are lots of problems with people contacting the maintainers of a project. You may stumble upon a GitHub project. There is no contact information. You can talk to people through pull requests and issues. That's about it. There's no mailing list link. There's no access to anything. You don't know who's running the project. And that is actually really challenging for people because they don't know about a mailing list. They don't know about a chat channel. So not knowing how to contact the project organizers can be a limiting factor if people have questions about how to contribute. Or are not really ready to jump right in with a pull request. There's lots of ways you can create ways to contact you and then share them maybe on the README in your GitHub profile or on your website if your project has one. So you can do email, you can have a mailing list, or you can just list separate contacts. One of the projects I'm involved with, we have like a marketing lead and a website lead, and all of their contact details are listed on a contact page. You want to have a bug or ticketing system of some sort so people can contact you that way, again, linked from your main page so people can find you. You want to have a chat channel, perhaps. It could be IRC or Slack or whatever you want to be using. Of course, I love IRC. That's where I always am. The one thing I'll say about the chat channel, since we're talking about a global community, is you want to make sure that people know where your community is mostly based, because if someone from Australia comes into your channel really late in the day, everyone else is sleeping, and that's not a great experience. So sometimes you might have like an entry message that says like, hey, we're active during these times, or something similar to that, just so they're not talking to a wall of, there's lots of people in here, but no one's answering my questions. Some projects still have forums or separate sorts of question and answer sites that you might want to have up in your contact page, just so people know how to get to your support resources. My second little tip is acknowledging feedback you get from users and contributors. This is probably my favorite one, because it's sometimes really hard to accept feedback, especially when you're running a project and doing lots of hard work. So you have to like deal with this feedback even when you want to hide, because the feedback maybe is unpleasant. Even if you have a really, really good reason for the way you're doing things. Like in OpenStack infrastructure, the OpenStack people in here will laugh. So we have really good ideas for some of the ways we do things. But the developers don't think they're such good ideas. But we're like, no, it's great. And they're like, no, it's really not. So you have to sort of reevaluate your options and the way you're doing things. Even though it seems like the right way, if people are telling you it's not, you should listen. Even if it makes you feel unappreciated, it can be tiring sometimes to run an infrastructure or be a project leader. You're doing all this work, you're working so hard on the project, and then people just complain all the time. Especially when the feedback is something you worked really hard on, and then people are just like, this is terrible, I can't use it. And you're like, aw. And even when people are a little mean, this was an actual exchange in the OpenStack infrastructure channel. They were like, why is someone ignoring my issues for 3 days? And we're like, well, it was the weekend. And they're like, oh, okay, IT support from 1990s. We're like, oh. Actually, we were like that. But then, you know, calmness prevailed. You know, we don't want people to either interact with us when we're grumpy because someone said something mean, or let feedback just fall into this black hole, right? When someone sends you an email, you should respond to it. When someone brings you some sort of issue in your chat channel, you should say something. Because people want to be listened to, even if it is just an acknowledgement of their feedback. Maybe you put it in a ticket somewhere and say, like, this is something we need to work on. And I will say that one person contacting you is often a big indicator of lots of people probably having the same problem. It's just that one has finally stepped up and said, I have this problem and I'm going to actually talk to you about it. So remember that it's not just one person complaining, it's probably a whole bunch of them having the same issue. So coming back to the cat, so you should stay calm when you have all this feedback coming in, because it can be hard to take. It's not personal. People aren't coming in there because they're angry with you. And they're also probably very frustrated. They have sought you out. They have looked up your contact information and figured out how to find you in order to make this complaint. And what they think they're doing is they are thanklessly maintaining open source software. They're thanklessly maintaining your open source software. So when they come to you, they're like, I'm trying to contribute something to your project. I'm writing docs, I'm writing code, I'm doing translations. I'm doing all this work, and your infrastructure or your community is not making that easy for me. So you have to understand that as a leader and as someone who's running infrastructure and someone who's leading this project, you're the one that they're contributing to. Now, in reality, it's not really true. We're all contributors, but it's not really how it looks to people who are coming to a project. And in the end, when you listen to this feedback and stay calm about it and take notes of things, the project will benefit. You're all there to make it better for whatever reason, whatever motivations you have. Staying calm and walking things through with people will make the project better. So another number four here is make sure you communicate changes in your project, in onboarding, in infrastructure changes to the community. You can do this by sending an email to the developer mailing list. No one will read it. I'm just kidding. No, but seriously, like, you can send an email just notifying people that things are going to change. If you're looking to make a change and you're not really sure how to do it, you can do a poll of the community and see if anyone who's interested enough wants to respond and have give you some input on that project or change that you're making. If your project has a meeting, or if there's a central meeting, either if it's like a leadership meeting or an infrastructure meeting or a project-wide meeting, you can make it a meeting topic, like, hey, we're going to make this change. So in OpenStack, we'll sometimes write emails like this, where Monty's like, it seems like one of those things where we should probably give you a heads up. So that was just part of an email where he was like discussing this big change. And again, like, people won't always read these emails and they won't always respond to them right away, but making sure that that information is out there, especially when you go back and make changes and iterate on your on the changes to your project, it can be a really good discussion point. So one of the things, I mentioned I spent several years on the Ubuntu project. One of the things we ended up doing as the Ubuntu Community Council is we would check in with teams. We learned that sometimes the frustration points, either they're not strong enough for people to complain, or people don't think their issues are big enough to complain to the community council. But the community council's like, hey, we're not doing anything over here. Like, if anyone ever has problems, come talk to us. And they're like, nope, you're too scary. You're the leadership. So what we did is we put together a schedule. So this is in 2016. We had a schedule of meetings with a bunch of different teams in the Ubuntu community. So every couple of weeks, we'd meet with a different team. Some of the things we'd ask during these little check-ins, we'd ask if they had any problems with the tooling. So if there are people writing documentation and they're really struggling with the format of the documentation or the process workflow, we could check in with them and see if they had any issues with that. Or processes, if you have any problems with any of the workflows or like in Ubuntu you need to package documentation. So some of those workflows were a little bit difficult, especially with when you lost someone on your team who had access to things. And then suddenly teams like, we can't do this anymore, and they wander off, and we're like, why don't we have docs? And so, yeah, having resources as well, so like making sure they have everything they need. And then we also would sometimes, if they say like, oh, we're all good, we'd be like, well, if there was something that could make things better, what would that be? And you get really interesting answers to this sort of question, because suddenly their like world is opened up to being able to ask for anything they want. They're like, well, in a perfect world, I would have, you know, this, that, or the other thing. You know, self-writing docs, yeah. But there are some things we can actually help with. So as a leadership team, you want to be asking your teams and checking in with them. We also like to ask what was working well, because in leadership, you want to know what projects are doing good, what, you know, sub-teams of your project are doing things well, so then you can share that knowledge with the other teams that you're interacting with. So number six here is document your processes. So when I was working both on the community council and in the OpenStack infrastructure, it was really valuable for people to understand what our job was and how we were doing things. That helped them interact with us and come to us with problems and empowered them to find solutions with us. So they knew what kinds of questions they could ask us, they knew what kinds of things we could help with. And then in the case of OpenStack infrastructure specifically, the entire infrastructure for that project is open source. So we documented everything we did, and we had everything be open source, so people could actually write patches against our infrastructure to make changes. They could even launch services, like Matt up here. He asks for things all the time, and we don't give them to him, so he launches them himself. We're listening, we just don't have time. but it was a way to empower the developers to actually make changes on their own. So it made sure we had to document everything so that they knew. Even if your project infrastructure isn't open source, or if your leadership doesn't really have that kind of interaction where people can do self-service, just making people aware of what sorts of things you can provide to them is helpful. Even though you have documentation, don't just tell them to go read it, because that's really off-putting. People hate that. One of the things, because it can be tempting, right? You answer the same question all the time. So finally you write docs, and people are still coming in and asking the question. you can still give them, you can give them a link, like, hey, like, this is a huge process, we've documented it here. But be responsive when people ask questions, even if they're documented. Like, people don't really like reading a giant wall of text. They have different priorities than you do. They just want to move on to the next thing. So you don't want to just throw documentation links at them and hope that they'll get it right and then ignore them until they don't ask the questions that are already documented. This one's probably my favorite one, sort of reading between the lines. So I gave all these tips about listening to people and responding appropriately, but most of the time, people will just never talk to you. Like, they'll have problems, they'll find workarounds, they'll do things that just try to work around. Because partially they don't want to take the time to learn how to contact you. Maybe they just don't want to, or they think that they can just solve their problem themselves without talking to anyone, and that will be fine. So being active on some of the mailing lists and making sure you're reading through the issues that people have and responding to things is important. Which I said. So this is a little snippet from an email on the OpenStack mailing list. They were talking about something completely unrelated to anything about infrastructure, really. And then someone's like, oh, by the way, like, I don't want to diverge, but like, there's this thing that's really annoying to me, and I have to look up how to do it every single time, and that's really hard. And we're like, wow, this thing they're trying to do actually shouldn't be that difficult. Maybe there's something in our infrastructure that we need to improve, because people are ranting about it on random threads on the mailing list. sometimes people come up with workaround tools. This one, there was like a, in OpenStack CI, like there's ways to like construct URLs to get certain like information back about jobs that were run. Someone actually wrote a tool to create the URL because they didn't know how, or they couldn't remember how to construct it all the time, which is really clever and funny, but we're like, you know, maybe we should make a link to some of these commonly used things or make it a little bit easier for these tools to be, or these URLs to be grabbed, because people are now writing tools around our infrastructure, and that's not necessarily the best thing. I think they're actually still using this one, though. this one was a fun one, too. So we have all of our logs in the OpenStack project, just like in Apache directory listings. So a while back, we had one guy on the QA team who would download several gigs of logs every day to do analysis against them. And we were like, oh, well, that's actually something we can help with. If you need to be searching through logs, you probably don't want to be downloading all this stuff into your local system all the time. So the funny thing is that it was months before we knew this guy was doing it, and I think we noticed it because we noticed a spike in our thing. We're like, who's downloading all this stuff from our log server at this time every day? And the problem got bigger because we had more and more logs, and so this is all growing. So we finally set up a Logstash server with Elasticsearch and ElkStack so that people don't have to download all the logs. They can actually do queries against it using a platform. So that was much better. and it was actually something we could help with. So that worked out really well for us and the project. And now our ElkStack is actually being used for lots of other things. There's something called Elastic Recheck, which does some of like automated detector failure detection, so that when people upload a change and it's a known problem why a test failed, it's not their patch, it's something we know about. We have like automation against that. And we never would have had that if this one guy wasn't just downloading logs all the time. So now we have this whole infrastructure for log analysis because someone needed something. And that was a huge help to the project. And this one I'm going to spend a little bit of time on is you listen to the feedback and you get all this feedback. But you also have to have principles in your project, in your infrastructure. So you have to come up with some principles. The first one is you want to have clear software choices. So in the Ubuntu project, we had some criteria of software we're going to use. The project is built around a platform called Launchpad. So a lot of the things want to hook into that. We want to make sure authentication is largely tied to that, because if we go out and have people make lots of different accounts for working on Ubuntu, they're not going to want to work on Ubuntu if they have to log into all these different things just to help out. You also have to make decisions about whether you have an open source policy or can anyone just throw up any proprietary thing they want. In OpenStack, we actually have to use open source software. That's part of what we do. So everything that we interact with is going to be open source. We also want to sort of set boundaries as to what we're going to support. So we're able to support users in certain ways, but we are a small team and we only have limited resources. So if you want to set up a service that we don't have on our agenda and we can't make priority for, we can't necessarily support everything. So what you need to do in that case is just be clear about how much time you have. Again, go through the documentation and say, if you really want to bring this up, you can make it a priority and start implementing it. And just do whatever you can to empower the people to help themselves. But just set boundaries, because you're not going to be able to solve everyone's problems all the time. People will contact you about things you can't fix. They'll contact you about things you don't have time to fix or can't make the priorities for. You also want to figure out what you're willing to compromise on. I think this is something I struggled with a lot in the infrastructure team I was on. We were pretty uncompromising. so you have to sort of figure out, like, you are doing things a certain way and you're really happy with how you're doing them, but you do have to make compromises and make clear, like, where you're willing to chat with people. And just take time to talk to them, understand the issues that they're having, and how you can work with them to fix things. And I also say you should, you know, trust your high-level view. As a leader or as someone working on the project infrastructure, you have a really good view into the whole project. So you know that changing this thing over here is going to impact these few projects over here, so you don't want to change that. But someone sitting here is going to say, if you just fix this for me, everything will be fine. But you can say, no, like, we can't change that because someone else is using it in this way. So by having this position in the project, you should rely upon all of that knowledge that you have and that high-level view that other people may not have. And then again, communicate why you can't change something. Don't just shut someone down and say, like, we're not doing it your way, go away. Just say, like, really go out and explain why these changes can't be made and why you can't make them happy all the time. And that's a very unique view that you may have into your project because you know so much about it. So you can explain it to people. So one example of this is one of the examples of the having principles is that, you know, again, in OpenStack, we can only use open source software. So we did this software transition because there was a piece of software that we were using, and it went closed source. And that was actually really, really disruptive to us and to our community. And the translators wanted to keep using the software. This was a piece of translation software. It was open source, so there was an open source project. We happened to be using the hosted version, but since it was open source, it was kind of okay for us to use it. But the translators were like, no, we're using Transifex, we want to use the software forever. This is what we're going to stay on. And so for a few months, I think it was a cycle or two, we were like, okay, but we need to move off of this. And they were like, no. So this ended up being a whole, I think it was about a year and a half we spent from the time it was announced that it was going closed source to us finally moving off of it. And in that, I learned a whole lot about listening to people who I don't necessarily work with all the time. I'm an American, which means I only speak English. So I don't work with translators that much, and I've never done translations in my life. So when we were presented with this problem of having to switch the software, it was our, as the infrastructure team and doing a lot of Python, we were like, we're just going to find the platform, the translation platform that runs Python, and we're going to slap it in, and they're going to be fine. Well, that didn't work out because the platform that we tried that had Python and would make our lives easier as infrastructure people, the translation team didn't like it at all. They didn't like the UI, they didn't like the workflow. So I set up a test instance and they just weren't happy with it. So we met at a summit, a developer summit, and we worked with them on finding a different platform. So Steve here has a shirt of Zenata, and that is the platform that we started testing with them. So we spent several months working with translators. We set up test instances, we started working on workflows, and we spent a whole lot of time learning about translations, POT files and PO files, and the whole churning of infrastructure that we have to support this, writing lots of scripts and making everything supported. And throughout this, we'd throw the demos back to them. We'd say, is this working for you? What is not working for you? And in the course of that, the Zenata team from Red Hat, they actually stepped in and started coming to our summits and working with us directly. So we were able to work with upstream and work with our translators to add features to that software. So the upstream was very responsive. They said, we need this and that to be able to adopt it. They started implementing those features. And so reason I bring this up is because it was a really, really good example of having very different groups communicating with each other for a really good end result. So upstream was adding features for us, the translators were having test instances to make sure they were happy with this, and even though they were really, really grumpy about moving off this old platform because change is hard, we finally went live and had a really successful translations platform at the end that was open source once again. So, you know, and that was because we stuck to our principles. Like, this was a lot of work, and it was a lot of communication, a lot of back and forth, a lot of in-person and like online meetings. But we really came out with an excellent result in the end. So I wanted to leave a bit of time for questions. But I'm just going to run through these 8 tips again to remind you, and then you can ask questions about all of them. the first one is interesting for me because, you know, I'm starting this new job and building this new community, and we don't have any way for people to contact us yet. And I'm like, all right, that's the first one I'm going to fix. But it seems really obvious, right, that people should be able to contact you, but it's not. So make sure you have a simple way for people to contact you, whether it's chat or mailing lists or whatever. And then just be conscious of time zones, because if people come into your chat and are ignored, that's really unpleasant. You know, acknowledge feedback and stay calm about it. People are not there to attack you. Communicate changes, be involved with your community. Like we did with the translations team, make sure that they're involved every step of the way when you're making a major change so that they're informed and you're not throwing things and messing up their workflow, because people are staking their livelihood on the ability to use your platform and be involved with your project. You don't want to change things without letting them know and getting feedback. Again, we had really good success with checking in with teams and reaching out to them and saying, we want you to tell us what your problems are. Even if you don't think they're major, we can probably help you fix them, or at least get you on the right track. Documenting your processes, making sure that everyone knows what you do and how you can help them, and then how they can empower themselves to help themselves. Being involved in the project infrastructure, or project mailing lists, like the development mailing list, because people will make side comments about things that are hard for them. And it's great to pick up on that kind of stuff. And then sticking to your principles. And you have principles for a reason. They're for the integrity of your project, and they're to make sure that everyone has a good experience and that you have a really good output at the end. So making sure you stick to those and understanding what's important for your community. So I have some time for questions.
Do you have any tips for dealing with toxic members of the community, the ones who actually are there to make your life difficult and never agree to anything, and you know the routine?
Yeah. So dealing with toxic members of the community. That's a very good question. I have some stories. Let me think how to phrase them. So in the Ubuntu community, it was one of the first projects that had a code of conduct, and that is actually enforced. People have to treat each other in a certain way. So we had an incident a couple years ago where actually a leader of one of the projects inside of our community was not behaving very nicely. And we felt that he was being toxic. And in the course of this whole we talked to him. We talked to people he was working with. We tried to really diffuse the situation, because we thought, you know, if we just get in the same room and talk to them, all understanding will happen. Like, if we just talk to them, we'll understand that maybe they're going through a hard time, or maybe they don't understand they're being so abrasive. And so we sort of go through this process every time someone breaks the code of conduct in a way that people are complaining about. And in most cases, it gets resolved. Like, really, like, they had a bad breakup and now they're taking it out on people in channel, or something happened where, you know, something in their life happened or they don't realize that they're being mean or that they're being abrasive or their communication style, or it's a cultural thing. We've run into that before where people are just really abrupt and really not very considerate with their communication. So most of the time it just gets resolved by sitting down and talking to people. In a few cases we have actually in the Ubuntu community had to remove people from their position and essentially kick them out of the project. maybe for a year, or maybe we just tell them to not be a leader for a while. But we have been very strict about that, because we know the price, you know, the toll that a toxic community member takes. It makes people not want to join, it makes people leave, and we understood from a very early point in the project that we didn't want to put up with that. In OpenStack, we've actually been fairly lucky because there are some people who are abrasive, but it's a much more professional context because most of the people are being paid to be there, and their companies want them to be reflecting well, so that kind of reins in behavior sometimes, I think, because they're representing a company, and the company's not going to be happy if this guy's always going around picking fights. You know, but there are times when people are just mean, and you know, you sit down and try to talk to them and work through it. But I'm a big fan of just kicking people out of projects, even if they're really talented. Like, if they're scaring people away, that's not okay. Like, the best teams I've worked on have been with a lot of really friendly people, and I don't do well with people who are not nice. Like, I go to a post office that's twice as far away than the closest post office because people are nicer at that post office. So people just go to another project. So yeah, thank you.
Any other questions?
Thanks, great talk. What about cross-project collaboration and learning? Do you have any experiences you could riff on that?
Yeah, so cross-project. I mean, like with the work on Zenata, like they came to us and they did demos of their software, and we worked really closely with them to try to make sure we had things working. I mean, I guess it depends on how interrelated the projects are. Like, for us, it was infrastructure, so we're using a lot of software. So we go to upstreams, we went to upstreams regularly, and we're like, hey, we need this feature, or this thing you changed is really ruining our lives. Or and most of those cases, it was just engaging. But it is harder when you have a downstream, and so those people are talking to you. And in OpenStack infrastructure, we actually did have that. A few companies were replicating the infrastructure we had. So some of the things we did, we were working with them, is like we had early on for our system configuration, it was one giant repository. Like all of our Puppet modules for everything, it was all in this massive repository. So if anyone wanted to use us and be a downstream to our open source project, they had to clone our entire thing and pretty much replicate everything and then manually take out what they didn't want, which made the delta between the projects really difficult. So while they were implementing that, they were giving us feedback throughout that process, like, hey, you really need to split out these Puppet modules. Like, we don't want a planet, a blog aggregator inside of our company. So like, if that was separate, that would be great. So we worked to like modularly weed these things out, and that was done. Part of it was done through meetings, part of it was done just through bug reports. People would just submit bug reports and say, like, I'm implementing this thing in my project or my company or whatever, and it's not working. And so we worked with them to figure out what we could do to make that better. And I'm really proud of the work that we've done in this way, because we have made a lot of really good improvements that not only helped them, but like they helped our project be a much better project because now it's more consumable.
I'm part of the infrastructure team of
OpenStack. Speak up a little.
Sorry, better now?
Yeah, thanks.
I'm part of the infrastructure team of our open source community, and I'd like to ask you, how do you balance the security that we have to make sure that it, what we deploy is secure versus making everything public? So clearly you cannot have the passwords in clear text or anything like that, that's easy, but I feel a little bit, I don't feel really good about putting the list of all the machines that I have, all the versions of every software, what does not have a working backup right now, and things like that. I feel like I'll be an easy target if I let everyone know my weakness. How do you balance that, making secure versus public, right?
Yeah, so an infrastructure question. So this one actually comes up sometimes, and there's a really funny story about this, because someone once submitted a bug to our infrastructure saying, I know what operating system you're using, I know what version of the software, you guys are gonna be so easy to hack. And we were like, won't fix. And we never got hacked by them, so like, I don't know, if you're so easy. I mean, what we do is so we are very public about everything. We list all of our servers, we list how we configure everything, all of our software versions. We're just really conscious about best security practices as sysadmins, so we make sure that we disable password logins. Of course, all your private data is secret. But we also make sure that security updates are run regularly. We're not running out-of-date systems. Like, we always upgrade our Ubuntu version to the latest version. It does mean we're depending heavily on vendors and making sure, like, if Ubuntu is not secure, then we're not secure. But if Ubuntu's not secure, a lot of people are going to have problems. So we're really relying on the open source community to keep us safe in that way. And OpenStack is a big project. There is, you know, millions of dollars, thousands of developers. There's a lot of people working on OpenStack, and we haven't really had a problem. So as one of the biggest open source projects out there, we're probably a big target, but we honestly haven't had any issues in that way. I mean, we have had some issues with people knocking over our services sometimes, like our Elk stack. Sometimes if you just shove too much at it, it gets a little wobbly. But for the most part, like, we just haven't had that problem. I'm sure we would come up with new security things if we started having problems, you know, if you think about it, you think, oh, yeah, that's going to be a huge problem, but practically it hasn't been. So that's not an invitation.
Okay, that looks like it's about it for now. Look, thank you so much, Elizabeth, for coming all this way to give this presentation. On behalf of the LCA team, we have a little token of appreciation
thank you.
for you. Everybody.